we cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
We fall down,
we lay our crowns at the feet.
Good morning, welcome to Twickenham. Thanks for coming out to be with us this morning. We are glad that you are here. Would you just do something with me as we start? I'd like for us to begin with a prayer. A lot going on in the world right now. There was a chemical attack in Syria last week. 80-something people were killed, among them many children. The U.S. responded to that with a missile strike. So it's an unsettling time, and I think we should just bring that to the Lord as we begin this morning. Let's pray together. Holy Father, we are so thankful that we can be meeting together unafraid, not worried about any outside force that would try to prevent us from gathering together as brothers and sisters and in celebrating your mercy and your love and your grace and in calling Jesus the Lord and crediting the Spirit with whatever gifts that we have. We're free to do that, and not everybody is. And right now we want to lift up the conflict in Syria. We pray for peace. We pray for healing. We pray for restoration. We pray that your kingdom will come in that part of the world. In fact, we pray that your kingdom will come all over the world, and that people will love you and love one another in obedience to the two greatest commands. We just lift up our leaders and the leaders around the world as they deal with what's going on, and we ask that your Spirit will prevail and that your kingdom will come and that healing will take place. Thank you, Father, for your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for doing that with me. Hey, again, glad you're here this morning. Thanks for coming out to be with us. Want to begin this morning by welcoming some new members to Twickenham, and I'm going to ask you guys to stand. John Swearingen is with us this morning. His wife, Anita, was going to be here, but she hurt her knee yesterday. So there's John, his son, Kyle Swearingen, as well, and then Brittany Zag. Can you guys all stand, and let's just give them a hand. Thank you guys for coming. Welcome. Glad you're here. John's wife is Anita, and so she's home nursing a knee and probably watching us online, so you can turn around and wave at the cameras and say, hi, Anita, and anybody else who's not here today. So if you are looking for a church home, we are always looking for new family members. Love to talk to you about how we welcome new folks. Just glad you're here. There's a card on the seat in front of you. You can fill that out. Any prayer requests, we'll be praying over those. And a little bit later in this service, Blake Boggs is going to lead us in a Lord's Supper meditation. Blake was our youth intern last year. He'll be with us again this year, and so we're glad to have Blake with us here. Let's stand. I want to read a passage of Scripture to you from Romans chapter 11 and the first part of chapter 12. It's a passage about worship and why we worship the Lord and why we're here. It says, oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that he should repay them? For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Let's praise the merciful Lord this morning.
I see the work of your hands. Galaxies spin a heavenly dance, O God. All that
You rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Would you be seated as we share from God's word? For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joint and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account.
Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need.
Let's take our offering.
Merciful God and Father, loving us like no other, hear our prayer, the cry of our hearts as we come to you. We acknowledge our transgressions, we confess to you.
Smith, Arkansas isn't known for very much. What it is known for is its historical site called the Gallows. In the 19th century, a man named Judge Isaac C. Parker was in charge, and he was known as the Hanging Judge. With a smack of a gavel, he said, "I sentence you to hang to 160 men and women." Could you imagine? Growing up, I imagined God as this judge, like Judge Parker, a God that showed no mercy, a God that was harsh and cruel and did whatever he did with a smack of a gavel. And when I read this story, I imagine walking into God's courtroom on Judgment Day. And from what I believe and I've heard all my life of how cruel and harsh he is, and his death total is so high, and you stand before him with all the sin that you have, and you think of all the people you've murdered with your words, your actions, or your hate, and he smacks down the gavel and says, "I sentence you to eternal life with me." Someone has taken your place at the gallows. You're free of all the charges against you. The mercy, the extraordinary amount of mercy. Let's pray. Dear Father, you are the perfect judge. Thank you for the mercy that you pour out on us daily. And thank you, Lord, for sending your Son to die on a cross for our sins. Bless us, Father, as we strive to show the same mercy that you've shown to us, to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
King Judge Parker was quoted saying, "I do not desire to hang you men, but it is the law." I'm willing to bet you know a hanging judge too. He didn't desire for us to hang either. And he knew the law. So he fulfilled it. Our hanging judge hangs on a cross so that we don't have to. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you so much for your mercy. Thank you so much for the blood of your Son that was spilled for us so that we may be forgiven. Again, Lord, I pray that we seek to be as merciful as you have been to us. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
And the
bring you praise from the inside out, Lord, my soul cries out from the inside out, Lord, my soul cries out, Lord.
Be seated.
So if you're visiting today, or if you haven't been with us lately, we've been in a series called High Definition Faith, or Faith HD, and what we're trying to do is to increase the resolution of some basic Christian beliefs. In fact, in this particular installment, we've been talking about finishing the sentence, God is, and we'll be coming back to this from time to time with other topics and texts that we want to look at, but we've been trying to finish the sentence, God is, and we're talking about some, but not all, of the attributes of God. It would be pretty hard. Well, I guess we could spend the rest of eternity talking about God, but we've been trying to just get clear on who God is. In some of the aspects of him that we really feel like we need to understand better. We began this series with finishing the sentence, God is believable. God is a plausible possibility. And that's kind of an odd way to begin, I suppose. But we wanted to start there because there's this idea, I think, that's been around in our culture for a very long time, that you can either be a person of reason or a person of faith. You can't be the same thing. And we just talked about the fact that there are some really good reasons for believing that there is more to existence than just what we can see and test. And the key word there being reason. There are good reasons, some good rationales for believing that there is a God. That's where we began. And then we said that God is different. We talked about God's holiness, God's complete otherness. There is no one, no thing like God. He is completely different than we are. We talked about God is everywhere. That's where we talked about his omnipresence. And so we don't have to be afraid of new situations or new places or new things because God is already there. And then God in control, God is in control, was the next place that we went in this conversation, which among other things means that you and I can resign our position as general managers of the universe because he's got this if we will let him. And then last week, God is love. So this morning we're going to finish the sentence in a way that I hope will bring you great comfort. And will bring, maybe open a door at least, to greater commitment on your part and on mine. And I ran across an interesting story that kind of invites us into this last idea in sort of a gracious way. It may or may not be true. This may be completely apocryphal. And I'll be honest with you, the story is so good, I didn't want to check it out, okay? That's just honest, all right? I'm being real honest with you. But it's a great story. It's about a mother who once approached Napoleon, and she was seeking pardon for her son. He'd been sentenced to die. And the emperor replied to the mother that he couldn't let the kid go because he had committed this offense twice, and justice demanded death. Kind of like the judge that Blake was talking about. And here's what the mother said. She said, "But I don't ask for justice. I plead for mercy." And Napoleon said, "But your son does not deserve mercy." And she said, "Sir, it would not be mercy if he deserved it. And mercy is all I ask." Napoleon was touched by her love for her son, and her logic was pretty irrefutable. So he said, "Well, then I will have mercy." And he released her son. So here's how we're going to finish the sentence this morning. God is merciful. And man, that's really good news. That is such good news. There are a couple of main Old Testament words that talk about God's mercy. When you see the word mercy in the Old Testament in your English Bibles, usually it's going to come from one of two words. There's the Hebrew word hesed, and if you're big into Hebrew, I know I'm not pronouncing that correctly, but I can't get my mouth to do what theirs does. It's a big, huge word, huge concept, and it means loving kindness, loyal love, steadfast love. One Bible dictionary says that chesed is mercy is the outward expression of, or the outward manifestation of pity, that it assumes need on the part of the one who receives it and resources adequate to meet that need on the part of the one who gives it. So mercy or chesed or steadfast love is this pity put into action, kind of getting inside somebody else's skin, understanding what they're going through, appreciating that, and finding a way to help them. The other word is rachamim. It comes from the Hebrew word, and I love this word, it comes from the Hebrew word for a mother's womb. Mercy in Hebrew comes from the word for a mother's womb. You put those two together, and I guess you could define mercy as womb-like mother love, loving kindness, compassion that God has in infinite measure. 2 Samuel chapter 24. Now, we always think that we think about God of the Old Testament, and this kind of way of thinking has been around for a couple of thousand years. It was wrong when it first got started by a guy named Marcion, and it's been wrong ever since. We always think that in the Old Testament, there's the God of justice, the hanging judge, right? And then the God of the New Testament is the sweet judge, the merciful judge. That's just not true. That's just false. 2 Samuel 24, David is faced with this impossible choice. He's sinned, and the prophet Gad comes to him and gives him three choices. He can fall into the hands of his enemy, he can suffer pestilence in the land of Israel, or he can face the punishment of God. And so here's what he says in 2 Samuel 24, verse 14. David says to Gad the prophet, "I am in deep distress. Let us fall into the hands of the Lord, for his mercy is great. Do not let me fall into the hands of people." Isaiah, another Old Testament passage, Isaiah the prophet knew this about God. Isaiah chapter 55, he says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the evil person his thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord and he will have mercy, and to our God, for he will freely pardon." There's another Old Testament prophet. And a guy, you look at this guy and you go, "Man, I'm sorry your parents named you this." Habakkuk. Can you imagine going through life with the name Habakkuk? But he knew that God was merciful. Chapter 3, verse 2, he said, "Lord, I have heard of your fame." We just sang about the Lord's fame. "I stand in awe of your deeds. O Lord, renew them in our day, and our time make them known. In wrath, remember mercy." So you've got all of these Old Testament passages that talk about this steadfast love of God, this loyalty of God, this aspect of God that is very much like a mother's womb, this mercy. But the New Testament talks about it too. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, he's called the Father of mercies. Ephesians 2, Paul says that God is rich in mercy. James chapter 5 says he is full of mercy. Paul knew about God's mercy in his letter to a young minister named Titus. He said, "But when the kindness and love of God," this is Titus chapter 2, when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us not because of righteous things we had done, which is really good news. You're not saved, you're not made right with God because you did it right. You're made right with God because of his mercy. Now this idea of mercy is obviously huge in the Bible. It's so big, in fact, that when God gave Moses the instructions for the tabernacle, you remember what the tabernacle was? That was Israel's mobile worship center. Right? They came out of Egypt, and then God gives them these instructions on how to build this tent. And this tent is going to be the place where they come to worship God. And what God does is he tells Moses, and we're going to look at Exodus chapter 25 if you want to turn over there. Exodus 25, second book of the Bible, Exodus 25. He tells Moses, I want you to construct one piece of furniture that will stand as a vivid illustration of my mercy. And so God details the dimensions and materials he wants Moses to use to make the Ark of the Covenant. Do you remember that? Did you see Raiders of the Lost Ark, which was the only good movie in that series, the first one? I want you to make this Ark of the Covenant, this chest that's nearly 4 feet long and a little over 2 feet wide. And he tells him to put the commandments that God gives him in the chest with some other stuff. Then beginning in verse 17 of Exodus 25, God describes the cover that's supposed to go on top of the chest. Now, this is some weird, tedious stuff, okay? So do you need to stand and stretch? Are you okay? Are you okay? This will you trust me? When we get to the end, this will be cool, okay? It's going to be nerdy getting there, okay? Theologically nerdy. There's no nerd as bad as a theological nerd. But when we get there, you go, oh, that's cool, okay? I promise you that payoff. All right, so here's what God says. I want you to build this chest, and I want you to put a cover on the chest. And God describes the cover in great detail. Exodus 25, 17. I'm reading this from God's Words translation. I love the way this translation puts it. Verse 17. Make a throne of mercy to cover the ark of pure gold, 45 inches long and 27 inches high. Make two angels out of hammered gold for the two ends of the throne of mercy, one on each end, one angel on each end. And form the angels in the throne of mercy out of one piece of gold. The angels should have their wings spread above the throne of mercy, overshadowing it. They should face each other, looking at the throne of mercy. So you've got two angels facing each other with their wings spread out over this throne of mercy. Verse 21, after you put into the ark the words of my promise, which I will give you, place the throne of mercy on top. I will be above the throne of mercy between the angels whenever I meet with you and give you all my commands for Israel. Now, a couple of interesting things that we want to note about this mercy throne, or some of your versions will say mercy seat or mercy cover. I think one even says lid, depending on which translation you use. First, this is the only seat in the tabernacle, or later on, the temple. The temple replaced the tabernacle. There was nothing called the seat or the throne of judgment. When God chose to create a throne for himself that Israel could approach, he named it mercy, not condemnation. You hear that? When God chose to create a place for Israel to come and meet him, he named it mercy, not condemnation. Second thing about this, the part about the angels spreading their wings over the mercy seat is really cool. I mean, you can see on the image there, we don't know if that's exactly what it looked like, because the Ark of the Covenant is in some government facility somewhere so the Nazis wouldn't get it. At least that's what I've been told. But you see how they got their wings spread out there? That's what we think it looked like. I wonder if that's what David had in mind in Psalm 57 when he cried, have mercy on me, O God, have mercy on me, for in you my soul takes refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings. I mean, David had seen the Ark of the Covenant, had seen the mercy seat. I wonder if he was thinking about that. Or Psalm 17. Show the wonders of your great love, you who save by your right hand those who take refuge from their foes. Keep me as the apple of your eye. hide me in the shadow of your wings. I wonder if this is what Jesus was thinking. I wonder if it was in his mind. When he looked at Jerusalem and wept over Jerusalem in Matthew 23, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who killed the prophets and stoned those who sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you would not." The most interesting thing to me, though, about the mercy seat is that it was located between God and his standard of perfection, the law. When God's glory came to the tabernacle or the temple, it would hover above the mercy seat. Beneath the mercy seat, in the chest, among other things, was the Ten Commandments. The mercy seat stood between God and his uncompromising law. Blake mentioned a minute ago about how Judge Parker would slam the gavel down and say, "I don't want to hang you, but the law requires it." There was nothing between Judge Parker and the law. Between God and his uncompromising law, though, was the mercy seat. Once a year, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest would enter into the Holy of Holies, and he would sprinkle sacrificial blood on the mercy seat. In a very vivid way, the mercy seat demonstrated that God's mercy stands between us and the eternal judgment embodied in the law. Now, this cover, this lid, this seat, this throne is only mentioned a couple of times in the New Testament. It's remembered in Hebrews chapter 9. But the mercy seat in particular comes up in Romans chapter 3. So I want you to listen to this, where Paul talks about the mercy seat. Romans chapter 3, beginning in verse 21. "But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There's no difference between Jew and Gentile. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith." Now, the astute sermon listener will notice that the words mercy seat or mercy throne or cover or lid didn't come up anywhere in that reading. But look at the phrase in verse 25, sacrifice of atonement. The Greek word literally means mercy seat. God presented Jesus as a mercy seat. Jesus stands between our inability to live the law perfectly and God's divine justice. What does that mean for us? Well, first, it means that God has gone to great lengths to set our relationship with him up for success. He knows that you and I are weak. He knows that you and I are prone to sin. And so he gave us himself in the person of Jesus to cover our sin, to put a lid on it, to hide it. You don't need to be afraid of a God like that. You don't need to pretend that you're better than you are. You don't need to pretend that you're better than anybody else. You don't have anything to prove. You don't have to get your life all straightened out before you make a move toward God. God knows how you and I are, and he has taken steps to deal with that. God is not against you. He is for you. Jesus is not a threat. He is your mercy seat. So when we talk about the fact that God is mercy, when we finish the sentence that way, that may be the most important thing we could say about him. Because that means that you and I can have a relationship with that God. And then second, since God has responded to us with mercy, and I love the fact that Blake prayed about this in his prayers, he expects us to respond to each other in mercy. He wants us to get inside somebody else's skin, to look at life through their eyes, to feel what they are experiencing, to move in and act on their behalf for people who are hurting, and even people who have hurt us. God wants us to respond in mercy to them. Micah chapter 6. This is the Old Testament, right? Micah 6. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Matthew chapter 5. In his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy." And then James, who characteristically is pretty blunt, puts it this way: judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. In other words, if you're unwilling to prevent others access to the mercy seat, access to the mercy seat will not be permitted to you. It's like the only thing God doesn't have mercy for is people who don't show mercy. When you kind of look around our culture right now, there is precious little mercy going on. Mercy is rare. If it were an animal, it would take a cryptozoologist to find it these days. That's why we've got to show it. We have to channel that mercy God has given us to other people. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, visited General James Oglethorpe when he was governor of the colony of Georgia. Now, I'm from Georgia, and I am fully aware that my state got started as a prison for people that England didn't want. All right, I know that. And James Oglethorpe was in charge of that. And when Wesley visited with Oglethorpe, Oglethorpe told him about a man who had done something to him, had offended him in some way and hurt him in some way. And Oglethorpe said, "I will never forgive him." And John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, said, "Then I hope you never sin. If we fail to show mercy, mercy will not be given to us." One of the reasons that we've been spending time talking about these attributes of God and finishing the sentence God is that a lot of people, and that includes us, finish the sentence in ways that are at best out of balance and at worst completely wrong. And some folks finish the sentence, "God is a hanging judge." That's what a lot of people think. That's what they feel. That's what they think about approaching God. They think that he's all about judgment and punishment and condemnation. And look, I'll be honest with you about this. There is plenty in the Bible about God's judgment and punishment and condemnation. God knows how to get angry. We could have talked about God's wrath, and we'll talk about that one of these days. That is a part of God. But God's throne in the tabernacle and in the temple was not called the wrath seat or the judgment seat or the condemnation seat. It was called the mercy seat, the mercy throne. And we've got to remember that. When we approach God, the throne on which he sits is named mercy. Whatever you got going on right now, whatever struggle you're having, whatever failure you have experienced, that does not need to keep you away from God. Do not let that failure, that sin, whatever it is, don't let it keep you away from God, because your God is merciful. He's not willing to let you just stay in it. He doesn't want to just let you live in it. But you don't have to be afraid to bring it to him. You do not have to be afraid to bring it to him. We have to remember that about God, and we have to remember that when we encounter people. We have to remember that we've been shown mercy, therefore we need to show it ourselves. "I plead for mercy," the mother said to Napoleon. "Your son does not deserve mercy," the emperor said to the mother. "It would not be mercy if he deserved it," she said. "And mercy is what I ask." The good news for you this morning is mercy is what God is. Let's have a prayer and then we're going to sing. Let's go ahead and stand, okay? God, we love you and we want to know more about you. We want to understand you. We want to understand you correctly. We want to love you with all our minds. And as we've been focusing this morning, we are so grateful for your mercy. God, I want to pray for, I have no idea who this might be, but I just feel like there's somebody in the room this morning, God, that they've got some stuff going on. They know it's not It doesn't, it's not, their lifestyle, their choices are not consistent with your law. They know that. And I'm just praying that they will see you as a God of mercy and that they will come to you to receive that mercy and to find that grace to help them in this time of great spiritual failure and need, and that you will embrace them and forgive them. Forgive us. Thank you that we can live under the shadow of your wings in safety and care there. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing.
Hide me away, O Lord.
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 In the day of trouble, beneath the shadow of your wings. Hide me away.
Hey, next Sunday is Easter, and I anticipate that we'll have a lot of guests that day. So I want to urge you, if you're a member here at Twickenham, would you see yourself next week as a host and be here a little bit earlier, be ready to greet folks, welcome them. You see somebody that doesn't look familiar, just go up and say, hey, my name is, glad you're here today. We're going to start at 9 o'clock next Sunday morning. We won't have classes, but we are going to have some food and refreshments down in the gym. And that'd be a great place for you to be at 8:45 next Sunday morning, just to be there and to greet folks. See yourself as the host. Welcome folks who maybe are searching. And we get the opportunity. If you don't have to go into a big theological discussion. Just welcome them. And let them know you're glad they're here. That's next Sunday morning, 9 o'clock. We'll start downstairs in the fellowship hall. A couple of things here that I want to point out. These are in the center column of your bulletin, but I really want to emphasize these. Coming up, we've got a thing called Brunch and Learn on Saturday, April 22nd. It's a lot about getting your financial house in order. Some of our brothers here are going to be leading that conversation. I would really urge you to put that on your calendar, be a part of that. It's free of charge. You can call our church office to register for that. Or email Steve at twickenham.org. Secret Church is coming up April 21st. You check your bulletin for that as well. And then I want to remind you that we are in a process of reconfirming our current shepherds. So if you haven't filled out your elder reconfirmation, I would really urge you to get on with that. There are hard copies in the lobbies. Come by the office, pick up a hard copy, or you can go online and register. And the password is, I think, in the bulletin. If it's not, call the office. So, oh, and the spring is tonight. And we're in here or downstairs? In here? At 5 o'clock. The spring is tonight. It's our instrumental service. Those are really cool. It's going to be a great night to come and sing and praise the Lord. And we're doing
Prodigal Son.
Prodigal Son. Ooh, some of us need that. In fact, I'm looking around. All of us need that. Steve Clark's going to lead us in our closing prayer. Come on up, Steve. Thank you for being here today. God bless you and have a great week.
Let's pray. Father, we just come to you today and we just praise your name for being so good to us and for loving us so much, Father. We thank you for being our God and for being our Father. Thank you for the beautiful weather you're giving us, the springtime, and Lord, all the new life. Lord, the new life in this congregation with the new births, as well as spiritual, as well as physical, Father. And we just pray that we can show this newness every day in all of our lives. We can be renewed. We thank you for your spirit that guides us and helps us with that. Father, please be with us as we try to be merciful. Lord, we know that we all need mercy. We're all the ones that need your mercy. We're all prodigals, Lord. And we just come to you and just praise you for being there for us and for taking that sin away and for being merciful and for loving us because of Jesus. Father, just be with us as we go through this week. Help us to be your servants. Help us to help others and to love them. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.